Hi, PBS families. Welcome to session three, Science Says, of the On My Way to K with PBS Kids Kindergarten Readiness Series for parents and caregivers just like you. My name is Janice Santee with WUCF, your Central Florida PBS station, and I am excited to join you on this adventure of lifelong learning in science for your blossoming learner. After viewing this session, please feel free to contact me via email, phone, or text message if you have any questions or looking for some resources for your child. Meet our education and engagement team. Shiana Valentine is our education and community engagement manager, and I'm Janice Santee, education and community engagement coordinator. So we have some exciting news for you. We have created the K-Ready site for caregivers, which has an outline of all of the resources from each of our sessions, including recordings, all of our presentations with clickable links, as well as activities and printables that are included in the session. Please remember that if you view any of the sessions to complete our survey, this allows us to keep this program available for your children and provides valuable feedback on how to improve our program. So today, we're going to learn about science, that your child is born a science. We're going to explore that. We're going to talk a little bit about science inquiry, what are some science tools that are appropriate for your child, and how to talk science with your child. We'll also give a quick overview of the areas of science and show you those connections to real-world discoveries that are made through the exploration of nature. Again, we'll also provide family resource links and where to watch PBS. When we talk about science, we always think of lab coats and fancy equipment that makes science sometimes a little scary for many of us. But truthfully, science is something that your child is born with. Do you know that your child's brain develops over the first 5 years more than they will develop in their entire lifetime? So we want to develop these comfortable relationships with science and experiences with their environment that they can build on naturally to grow as learners and build their curiosity. So let's look at your child as a scientist. When we look at these pictures, I want you to think about looking at the child from a parent's point of view and looking at the experience that the child is having from a child's point of view. So let's start with this picture here. If you see this child, she's looking under a rock. As a parent, I automatically think, oh, don't get dirty, you know, be careful, don't fall, get hurt. But if we follow our children's lead, you're going to see that they're looking and they're already curious. I wonder what's under there. They may discover some insects or other small rocks. They're already leading you into what is interesting to them. This child at the bottom, she's pulling on a vine. So that is a great opportunity. Yes, we think don't break the plant, but it is a child's way to investigate nature. What is this? It looks just like the leaves. A great opportunity for us to have that discussion. This child over here at the bottom, this is a face of experiencing rain for the first time. Imagine being a child looking up and there's water falling from the sky. How does it feel? What does it seem? The texture of it. Do you feel cold? Does it feel hot? It's warm. So imagine that feeling. We as parents want to say, get inside, you're going to get wet. But it's an experience for them. So that child on the bottom over here, looking at dirt, they're feeling that texture that it goes through their hands. How does mud feel? How does sand feel? What's the difference between the two? Of course, we're thinking, don't get dirty. This child up here who's looking at an insect for the first time, looking, knowing that that insect is alive, understanding that it has legs, it has body parts. For us, it's like, don't put it down. We want to make sure that you don't get hurt, but they're looking at an insect and observing the qualities of living things. And if you look at the child up here at the top, this is a picture of a child who is discovering their shadow. So look at that face. Do you see that? They're understanding, they're causing something. And when they move, it causes a shadow. So what is that all about? What a great opportunity to discuss science and let your child's curiosity lead the way. Science is one of the subject areas that all subjects could be taught from. So when you look at science, you can talk about language and you can explore words and sounds. You can also talk about the world around us and the environment and other people that live in the environment as well. It's a great opportunity to talk about math because it's part of the STEM relation as well. And health and nutrition. Think about that, how plants grow in nature and environment. So science is the well-rounded area, but of course we address in PBS Kids, we address the whole child. So looking at this picture gives you an idea of the shows that align with each of your own child's area of development. We also have learning goals attached to each of our shows. So in the area of science, technology, engineering, and math, we have a variety of applications and shows that align to the standards your child is learning in pre-K, kindergarten, and early childhood as well. Looking at the learning apps also have goals, learning goals. Again, sorted into areas of learning, of development. So let's take a quick look at what scientific inquiry is. What does that mean? What does it look like in my child? What standards are they learning? And how are they developing in this area? Let's visit the digital version of the On My Way to K with PBS Kids Kindergarten Toolkit. So on pages 1 and 2, we're going to look at the standards approaches to learning. And approaches to learning applies to all content areas, whether it's math, science, social studies, language. That is how a child looks and problem solves different opportunities and events that they encounter. For example, how does a child think of how to solve a problem? Watching children and seeing how they approach their learning will give us a lot of clues to how some children prefer one method of exploration against others. For example, on this section, you'll see that How I Grow provides an explanation of the areas of development in this standard. The following section, Help Me Grow, provides some caregiver strategies you can use with your child to develop this area of learning. And then the bottom section, Let's Explore Together, are the shows that are aligned to this specific standard. The study of the natural world is the standard for scientific inquiry. Children will study both living and non-living things. They're going to inquire, ask questions. They're going to observe and predict, and they're going to experiment, just like that child did lifting up a rock and looking and seeing what's under there or feeling that soil. These are the ways that children learn, and this is the standard of scientific inquiry. We also have a variety of areas within the scientific inquiry standard. We have, of course, investigation and inquiry. So children discovering, asking questions, exploring. We have the area of physical science, which are the characteristics of property like energy and non-living matter, how things move and how recycling and the environment. We also have life science, which includes living and non-living things, our senses, and plants and animals, including humans, because the study of the life cycle of humans is part of the life science standard. We have earth and space. So the exploration of air and water, the states of water, the states of matter, how children develop their senses and use the senses in this area, the nighttime sky, the daytime sky, all these are going to be falling under that earth and space standard. And engineering and technology. How do we solve problems? How do we address the problems we talked about? And the first one, approaches to learning. But what do we do and how do we create tools to solve problems? Children can create very simple tools. It's not as complicated as it seems, but it does require them to think a little bit outside the box of solving problems. We'll see that this next page is the Help Me Grow area, which provides caregiver strategies for using this standard and little activities that you can do. And the bottom, of course, Let's Explore Together, refers to all of the games and apps that address this area of development and this standard in your child. We're going to take a quick visit to page 34 and 35 because there's an activity included in this booklet called the Cloud Viewer. And it's something that you can actually cut out of the book and use with your child. So let's take a quick look to page 34 and 35. Page 34 and 35 can actually be cut out of the book because they are back to back with this picture. So when you cut this, there are two cards. You can cut them in half. And at this blank box that you see under the title, Look Up in the Sky, you can cut out this area right here. So what you do is you have your child look through that little box up to the sky. And when they see a cloud, they can start to compare what they're observing to the pictures of the clouds and the types of clouds around the card. Now they're looking at clouds from a different point of view. The clouds are also not just clouds, but they're different types of clouds. It's just creating an awareness of part of Earth and space science. Now that we have an understanding of what science standards are for young children entering kindergarten, let's look at the examples of the process of science inquiry. The process of science inquiry is a never-ending process. It starts with observing and being curious about the world around you. As we discussed before, when we talk about science for young children, we are engulfed in nature. Nature is what they have these experiences in and they participate in every day. So now that you're curious about something, you start to investigate that and you can discuss it. You can plan if you want to figure something out. You look at it. You can create some kind of experiment if it's something that you want to see how it works. And then you always ask questions and share their ideas. That's what scientists do. Communication with each other so that they draw these conclusions and create understanding. The more that you do science with your child, you are now building a layer of what we call prior knowledge. So now they understand something or have an experience with something that they can build upon and learn new material. As we saw in the pictures of children learning about the environment at the beginning of this presentation, we can think about how these children went about exploring the environment. One of the crucial things that your child will use are their five senses: what they see, what they hear, what they smell, what they touch, and what they taste. So we always want to be cognizant of what can we provide, what experiences can we provide, or we can see what they're looking at so we can show them and guide them. Oh, what does that sound like? What does that smell like? One of the things that we want to caution is about children will like to look at things and put it in their mouth. So we always want to make sure that we tell them that, you know, we don't put things in our mouth just because we're learning about them. And we want to make sure that we all stay safe, unless it's food, of course. Here are some great resources that talk about the five senses. We always know that kids learn best by cause and effect, and that relationship. Well, this happened. If I planted a seed and I water it and I added and there was light, it will grow. So the cause of planting, the effect is the growing. They use their five senses to understand these experiences in the world around them, because those are the tools that they carry with them every single day. Here are some examples of a five senses poster, a song, Count Your Senses, and an activity with Curious George about the five senses. So how can we foster curiosity? How can we encourage them to be curious about the world around them? Well, families, it really starts with you. When you model interest about the world around you, kids are going to follow. You can ask questions when you're walking and taking a nature walk, or working in the backyard, or if you go to the park, or if you just are in the grocery store thinking about the vegetables. Where do you think that grew from? Oh my gosh, I wonder if that one has seeds. So all these are questions that help the kids start thinking and formulating questions, or even curiosity about what they are seeing and what their environment is. In this video clip, Traveling Seeds, Nature Cat and his pal Hal are trying to figure out why there's so many weeds in the garden. Well, it turns out that Hal, his friend, has run through the garden flowers and those little seeds have gotten stuck to his tail. So as he runs through the garden, he's been spreading the seeds, which is really what happens in real life. Animals are eating plants and the seeds get stuck to their fur and they travel, or birds with seeds, and they drop them and they also spread the seeds. So let's take a little closer look at what that looks like. Here is a real world example. The other day, I was taking a walk and I noticed that so many flowers or weeds were just covering the sidewalk, the area by the sidewalk. So I decided to get my phone and I took a picture of the flowers. But then I was curious. So I went in a little, I zoomed in a little more, and then I saw all of the pollen in that little flower. So I started to think, oh yes, there must be a lot of insects or bees that come around this area. So when I looked at the flower next to it, I happened to see a little insect in there. And that made me think, look at that. You can see his legs. You can see his antennas, all that with one picture. What is that showing us? That we may not see everything that's happening in nature, but it works independently from us. So our curiosity actually leads to discoveries. Let's explore this concept of seeds a little further. So we're going to get our magnifying glass. We're going to look at this paper flower. So this paper flower actually has embedded seeds within. So when you're actually looking close up to this flower, you may be able to spot the seeds and see those bumpy, bumpy areas. That's a great discovery. The fact that your children could say, well, this feels bumpy or feels rough, and I can see the texture of it and I can see the seeds inside. Take any seed. This happens to be a paper flower with seeds embedded, but any seed, and just get a patch of soil and plant the seed with your child. Water it. Take a piece of paper, create a journal of when you planted that seed, or use your phone. Phones are a great tool to record when paper's not handy. So take a picture of the seed that you planted the first day. Wait 4 or 5 days, take another picture. wait another week and take another picture. Do that for like a month and your child will see the progression of this seed grow. Something that's not observable right away because it does take time for plants to grow, but it starts to give your child an understanding that when they're walking down the sidewalk and seeing things grow, that they will, that it took time and those seeds were planted before they even knew that they were there. Science talk and science tools are an important part of science. For example, talking about science could be as simple as substituting or adding science-related words into conversations that you have with your child. Let's observe that plant together. Oh, let's investigate it some more. Can you help me pull these weeds? What is growing out underneath those weeds? Oh, I see a feather on the floor. I wonder what bird that came from. You can predict what do you think is going to happen when something falls or drops, or when the leaves are falling down, predict why that happened. What's going to happen next? Are all the leaves going to fall off? You can plan and collect data. Collecting data, as we talked about, could just be as simple as using your phone. And that provides some degree of evidence for your child. So using that as evidence, for example, when I discussed those flowers growing, I could say, oh, that insect, that's evidence of how these flowers are growing all over the garden without even having to investigate it further. That was the evidence. And now I can say, this is one of the reasons why. You want to compare and contrast, and you want to talk about your results. When you do something together and you plant your seed, why? What were the results? If you forget to water it for 2 weeks, what are the results of not watering a plant? So scientific talk is something that's easily embedded into everyday conversations. Also, science tools. And again, we've said this several times, a simple phone is now something that can replace a magnifying glass. It can also replace a binocular when you're looking at certain objects far away. As simple as a notebook or some crayons, or even your dry erase sleeve with a dry erase marker. One of the printouts you can use when doing science is the Eleanor Wonders Why Science Notebook. So you have a plastic sleeve like this, which you can get at the dollar store, and you insert your curiosity sheet or your science notebook sheet. And you can draw in this, for example, the first page is your child will draw themselves. But the second page of this journal includes a let's be curious page. So now if you're going outside on a nature walk, or you're going to the park, or you're just in a yard, or you're having an experience in maybe the grocery store, even with your child, you can take your plastic sleeve, put in your curiosity page, and now give your child their dry erase marker, and they have an opportunity to draw what they're curious about. And then it gives you something to talk about and to continue to further investigate. The great thing about these is you could just erase it, and the sheet that's inside, you can use over and over again. Now, even if you don't use the curiosity journal like this, just a plain sheet of paper will suffice. And it gives the child an opportunity to start writing and recording their thoughts and observations. You'll find a few resources that will give you examples of how to create a nature journal. And you'll also find a video here, Word of the Day Journal, which explains what a journal is in kid-friendly language. We also have a few apps that you can download on your mobile device that helps you explore the outdoors, that you can take pictures of things you see, plants, animals, just follow along and create a collection of pictures to record your observations. When your child is exploring nature, it's always wise to encourage them that observation is the number one tool. Not always to touch things, because there are some things that we don't want to touch and we don't know about. So how do we do that? Well, you can find a simple tweezer like this at your local dollar store. And the tweezer has two indentations on the top for the fingers and one indentation on the bottom. So when your child holds this correctly and they practice this pinching method, they can pick up samples, for example, of leaves, of a rock they want to investigate, of a feather, and put that on either a piece of paper or a piece of cardboard, and to explore it further with their magnifying glass, they can do that safely. The other reason that using a tweezer such as this is important is because it strengthens these fine motor muscles. And when you look at these muscles, these three fingers are the key muscles to writing. So not only is your child investigating science, but they're also strengthening the fingers and that grip that they're going to be using for writing and drawing their observations or letters, sounds, and all other areas. We know there are many scientists who study different areas of science. In this little video, Let's Be Scientists, our little friend pretends to be a scientist, and his dog Potato is drinking water. He's very thirsty. So he discusses the ways that plants drink water and the ways that humans drink water. He also does a variety of experiments in different areas of science. So let's look at some of those areas of science and do some experiments in each. One of the most interesting areas of science for young children is life science. Life science talks about plants, animals, how they're the same and different, how they go through life cycles. Think about when you were a baby, pictures of themselves when they were babies and pictures of themselves now. Or maybe when you were a baby and as a teenager and maybe present today, so that they understand that people grow and change just like animals. They also like to talk about living and non-living things. How about rocks outside? Those are non-living things, but they're part of our environment. And that animals and people need different habitats, and different animals need different habitats than other plants. For example, like our little scientist video had shown, talks about that people drink water. But plants can't drink water the same way. If you put it next to a plant next to a cup of water, they can't drink the same way. So they drink using their roots. And this is a weed, so I'm just weeding the garden. But they have children understand that by these experiences that when you have to actually pour the water and the plant has to be planted so that it could suck the water through the roots. These are just simple everyday experiences that you can have with your child when you go outside, just pull up a weed and look at it. So let's look at a game that we can play that talks about the animals' life cycles and the similarities and differences of animal habitats. And this game is called Eleanor Wonders Why. It's on PBS Kids and it's called Pond Life. So in this game, we are going to create a pond and we're going to talk about the natural elements that you need to create this pond.
Play. Click this button to look at the creatures you've discovered. My animals. Look at all the living things you've discovered. Click on them to learn more.
So I started creating my pond, and I'm going to go back and I want to create a new pond that has new animals and a new habitat for my animals.
Ooh, we can make a whole new pond.
See what happens if you try adding new plants and animals to your pond. Rocks.
So we can talk about that rocks are non-living things, and when you click this book, it'll tell you a little bit about rocks. So I'm going to put some rocks in my environment. I think those are good. See what's next. Oh, maybe one here.
Great. Now there's lots of places for the animals to live and hide.
So now we've already talked that animals hide and use the environment to hide in. So we could look at even the algae that's growing on this rock. That's a really neat feature.
I noticed that the rocks look green up close. That's because they're covered in algae. What do you notice?
So a lot of that questioning back and forth.
Underwater plants. Floating plants.
Oh, so plants that float. And some are underwater. Some are floating plants. How exciting is that?
Underwater plants will help feed lots of pond animals. I wonder who will eat them.
So now we talked about habit places to hide, food that the animals will need because some animals eat this food.
Worm, snail.
Here's some worms.
These wiggly worms are so tiny. I wonder what other small animals live in the pond.
So we can continue investigating and adding features.
Dragonfly larva.
To our pond. Oh, I need variety right here.
Wow, I wonder how many tadpoles are here. Count how many you see.
And you can continue on exploring this pond life and creating a habitat for those animals who live there. That's how we start to take the information that kids are learning and they start to transfer it into what they see in their everyday life. Thanks, Eleanor. That was really fun. You can also explore these nature cat and dinosaur train and Hero Elementary games from PBS Kids, as well as download some apps for your mobile device, such as Nature Cat's Great Outdoors, which also includes a compass so that he can tell which direction is north, south, east, or west. What a great opportunity to discuss that with your kids. You can also play Splash and Bubbles, which is one of our shows that talks about the sea life and the animals and plants and adventures underneath the ocean. How about physical science? So physical science for young children is about how objects move, how they force, how force moves, that you push and you pull. It also talks about the states of matter, things that are liquid, solid, and gas. We talked about materials, the clothes you wear compared to other objects in your environment, and the relations of light objects to light. Here's some cool games that you can play. How about painting with water? And some apps that you can download, including the Play and Learn Science app, which has a variety of great activities, including materials that would help you, that you protect yourself from getting wet, what kind of materials. It talks about weather, and you can create your own thermometer. How would you dress for the weather? So those are all physical science. So let's do some physical science activities. Let's talk real quickly about force and motion. So here I have, I'm just using my On My Way to K book as an example, and I have a marker. I can just simply talk about if I place this marker here, it will stay. But if I incline this ramp, it'll fall. But what happens if I incline it really high? Oh, it really falls. Oh, it fell all the way to the floor. So just simple everyday explanation of moving objects and creating ramps and sliding is a way to teach physical force and motion. Let's talk about the properties of materials. So how about your clothes? That's sort of a cloth. But you know, how about that dry erase sleeve we looked at? That's plastic. And you know, my tweezers were also plastic. That's something else. Our pipette. That's plastic too. So there's a lot of plastic. Let's see what other materials I can find just right around here. How about these scissors? Look at the top of those scissors. Those seem plastic, but look at the bottom. That seems to be metal. So now we've talked about cloth, we've talked about metal, we've talked about plastic, we've talked about even paper. The papers that we've used to put inside our sheets. So just that conversation and being aware of the things around us and what materials are being used. When we use a plastic water bottle or we use glass, those are also types of material. Everyday conversations with everyday items. So how about states of matter? Well, that sounds a little complicated for little children. Or the relationship of objects to light. Well, let's look at simple ways we can use that. If we want to talk about the properties of the matter, we can talk simply about the states of matter. We can talk simply about using an ice cube. So here's an ice cube. My ice cube is partially melted because I left it out for a while, but I also can talk about force and I can talk about friction. So if I take my ice cube and I put it in between my hands and I rub really quickly, what happens to my ice cube? It literally, in those few seconds that we have been talking about it, it has almost disappeared because we've created this friction with our hands to make that ice disappear. So how about taking it outside, putting it on your sidewalk, seeing what happens to ice when you leave it out there for a while? How does it change? What happens if it's there for 5 minutes or 10 minutes? If it evaporates, what does that mean? You see, when rain falls, we have rain on the sidewalks, but the next day they're not there. So How does that evaporate? What does that mean? That's a great opportunity to talk about that, the states of matter. We can also use our phone as a simple device just to create some shadows. So when we talk about shadows, it's really the blocking of light that makes a shadow. The closer we are, the further away, the smaller the object seems. And the closer it is, gigantic. So we can play with shadows, turn off the lights, play with get your phone out, make some shadow shapes, talk about the distance of those shadows. How can we change it? Things are not always what they look like when you're playing with shadows. For your young child, science about Earth and space refers to buoyancy. How about floating? How something flows, how something moves. When you pour water, does it float? Does it sink? Here's a great activity from Cat in the Hat that gives you an experiment and a sheet where your kids can document if something floats or sinks. Grab a bunch of things around the house and do an experiment together. How about objects that you find in your environment, like soil and mud, and again, cool rocks? Or when you talk about movement of the atmosphere, it would be about sun, how the sun moves, how the clouds move, the moon, the stars, just observing that, and the cycles of day and night, and most important, weather, and how it impacts our daily life. So what can we do? We can provide examples for our child to talk about weather, and in everyday conversations, when your child is getting ready to go and get dressed, maybe if it's for school or if it's just for a walk or a play date or going out, then talk about, well, what does it look like outside? Is it cold? Is it warm? Is it hot? And you know, in Florida, it's usually hot. Then how would we dress? Oh, I know. We need a very, very big, thick jacket. Oh, no, that would be uncomfortable. How about some jeans or maybe shorts? Oh, shorts would be better. Yes, because then we are dressing appropriately for the weather. So just in those everyday conversations you're having with your child, talk about ways to get dressed. What kind of clothes are the best for that type of season? And another fun activity to do when you're looking at this area of earth and space science with your child is discussing the cycles of day and night. So here's a very simple activity you can do. Get a piece of paper and you cut it into the shape of a circle. And then you draw on the circle, a clock face, starting with 12 all the way around. So when you take this out, you could take this outside, and if you have a stick or a pencil, you poke a hole in the middle of this paper and you put it on the ground. Now, the 12 has to be facing north. Okay, so place it facing north. Now, I'll give you an example using the light from my phone. If I have this pencil outside, I can go and visit. I can put it outside facing correctly, and I can tell you more or less what time it is based on the position of the sun. And so one way to show your child that time does, the position that the earth does rotate, is that we could look at how time changes based on the direction of the sun. So when we can put this outside, they can go back a little while later and see what changes in that clock they see, so that it can show them from the morning to the afternoon that it does change. And then you can explain to your child why it changes and give them some real world applications. But this is a great activity you can do, and you're not touching it, so your child is actually watching nature at work. Engineering and technology also sounds like a really difficult task to do with young children. But the truth is, they can design simple tools and improve their experiments by just playing around with things like, how tall can you build a tower without tumbling over? And what changes can you make to help the bricks on the bottom stay straight? I'll give you a really fun example of a tool that you can create with just simple at-home materials. So I'm using two plastic cups. You can use paper cups that you recycle. I use two pieces of string, and I have taped them onto the side of the cup. So I have two of them. So I'm going to take a regular hanger, and I'm going to take one of the sides of my string, and I'm going to tie it around the hanger like this. Like so. Then I'm going to take the other side and I'm going to tie it around as well, like this. So now what I've created is a very simple scale that we can talk about. We can talk about this can pivot if something is heavier than something else. And now you can go around your house and experiment by looking for objects to put inside the cups and see which one is more, which one is less. I'll tell you what I did when I was doing this experiment. I realized that I put my tape too low. So when I originally did it, my cup tipped over. And so I realized I had to change my design by adding a piece of tape at the top. But this is how we learn. We try, then we modify our design and improve it. Here are some apps you can download on your mobile device and play along with your child. Experiment on engineering techniques and creating tools and solving problems. The Cat in the Hat invents, play and learn engineering, play and learn science, which is the one we talked about before, and Jet's Bot Builder. So in this one, we're trying to build a robot. So much fun. Here's also an example of the engineering design process and some similar to what I used when I created my hanger, my balance hanger. I had to define a problem I wanted to balance. And so I imagined and planned what I wanted to use. I created it, I tested it. And then I told you that I had to improve it because I put the tape in the wrong area. And then I shared my design with you. That was an easy idea to do and fun and in doing engineering as you're going along with your child. So how has science shaped our world? Let's look at some connections to real-world applications that science has been a major contributor to. It all is based on the design of nature. So when we look at birds and we look at sharks, the airplane wings or the aerodynamics was based on observations of animals and how they glide in different areas, whether it's underwater, in the sky, with wind. Did you know that Velcro was a product of seeing those little seeds that stick to your socks and are so annoying? Sometimes they are the pinchy ones. Well, Velcro is just like that. There's the hook and the loop side that Velcro together. That is modeled after nature. And did you know that when they were creating syringes, they looked at insects who can inject into, you know, when you get a bug bite, whether it's an ant bite or a mosquito bite, and how they can inject and what they use to deliver that. So this is how syringes were modeled after nature. Nature is really the exploration that your child is going to contribute to and be involved in every single day that has to do with the discovery of what is happening in the world around them. Let's look at some other tools you can use just to explore science. So this is a magnet. Now, if you don't have a magnet like this, and you know you can get that at the dollar store, you can just get a regular simple magnet. And you can talk about different things that are attracted to magnets. For example, I have here that's a bingo chip, but that is surrounded in metal. So I can talk to the kids about the material this is made out of. Well, it's made out of plastic, but if they look and observe closely, they can see that there's a metal on the side of it. So what happens when I put it near my magnet? I have a variety of them here. How fun is it to figure out what sticks to magnets? Continuing this conversation, let's look at a pair of scissors. This up top part of the scissors are plastic. So we can talk about those material. That's a plastic piece. No, it doesn't stick. But we talked previously that the bottom part of the scissors was made out of metal. It sticks. Oh, so now I'm seeing a pattern in science, that in at least in magnetism, that it sticks to metal objects, not plastic objects. Here's my pen. It's plastic. It doesn't work. Here are some a piece of tape that I had. Nope, that didn't work either. So, but it did stick to the top of the tape. I wonder why. Oh, I see why. If I remove the tape, the little cutting edge is metal. So that again reaffirms my prediction that magnets are that attract metal objects. Take a bunch of things around the house and experiment with those and see what is metallic, what isn't. Is your chair metallic? Is something around your the area on your child's table metallic? Is money metallic? Is silverware metallic? So many questions. So another activity you can do, and this is really simple and so fun. So I took a little bit of water and I put some food coloring. Now, if you don't have food coloring, I didn't have food coloring. So what I did was I actually took a marker. This is a great thing to do with your old markers that you think are dead. They're really not. You just put them in there, and I literally gave it a swirl like 3 or 4 times, and it turned the water yellow. I did the same thing with the blue marker, and I turned the water blue. So how can I experiment with colors? I can use the pipette to talk about, well, what happens if I mix colors? So I pulled a little bit of the blue and I put it into, oh, and I can see it already changing colors. Wow, that was quick. So what other colors can I make? How can I mix them up? These are really simple activities, but it gets children thinking and understanding that, you know, in nature, there are certain things that you can observe. In the physical world, day and night, the things change. But these observations, keeping a journal, a track of drawing, taking a picture of things that you discover together, is really going to create a background knowledge for new information they're going to learn in school. And they're going to be able to say, oh, I remember when I made this with my mom or my dad or my grandma, or I went outside with my uncle or my friend and we discovered. And so now they have a way to discuss the new learning and apply it to that old learning. That's what we want, to build these scientific minds and develop that lifelong learning for our children. Here you're going to find a bunch of resources that are all aligned to science. The Eleanor Wonders Why collection, of course, Wildcrats, Sid the Science Kid, Dinosaur Train, Curious George, Ruff Ruffman, Ready, Jet, Go, and The Cat in the Hat knows a lot about that. All of these areas, they encourage speaking and listening, storytelling. You can write in your journals and just a piece of paper about what they're observing. You can use letters and sounds that you're talking when you hear the words that you're talking about or the experiment and talk about, well, I want to write, you know, the water, it floats. What letter does begin? What sound is? How can I write that letter? All of those connect learning across the curriculum to your child. And of course, creativity, because I mean, cups to make a hanger, you got to think about that. Those are really fun ways to think outside the box and develop that love of learning for your child. So where can you find PBS resources? Well, you can download the PBS Kids video app. You can watch TV live, and now you can even download shows from there. You can play some of those games we talked about on PBS Kids Games. You can also watch some of the video clips on YouTube. PBS Learning Media is the site that many of our teachers use throughout our 9 counties in Central Florida that we serve, and they're all aligned to the standards that your child is using. So many of these resources that we've included in here come from that source as well. And of course, the 24/7 Kids channel, which you can watch live on the PBS video app, or you can watch on your antenna or over cable. So parents, you have homework. For this session, I would love for you to download one of those science apps that we talked about earlier in the beginning of this presentation that were part of this pink sheet that talks about all the ones that were under the STEM. So download something that you think is interesting to you and your child, and then look at it. Make sure that you identify some area that you want to play with them, and then play that area. Don't just click, 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 because we want to identify what we want to play and then spend those 15 minutes 3 or 4 times a week on a focused area that you have chosen. So this is intentional media that we're doing with our children, and intentionally choosing the activities. I'd like for you to go on a nature walk. It doesn't matter where you are, but a nature walk, take your binoculars with you, take your magnifying glass with you. Look at those little things. Have your child write it down in their journal, whether it's the dry erase or just a piece of paper folded in half, but keep an observation of something that they see. Have them write and talk about it, and then share it with someone else. Because when you share your knowledge, you're cementing the information that you've learned. These are great fun activities. It doesn't take a lot of time, and it's going to also encourage your child to continue to explore nature. Here are the links to the family resources that we talked about earlier. So you can find the links on our WCF site, our On My Way to Kids Early Learning site, PBS Kids and Parents site, PBS Learning Media, and some of our other partners in our community. So if you have any questions, you have my contact information. I thank you for watching this presentation. Please feel free to reach out if you have any questions, and keep being curious. Have a great day, PBS Kids and PBS families.